maybe a year or maybe 2 years into the gold bull market, we could start to see silver outperform for a variety of reasons. Not only from a sort of humanitarian point of view, I don't like to profit from other people's suffering, but I think it's a mistake, to think that gold will move up and sustain those moves because of geopolitical events. So clearly, I'm not a geopolitical strategist, but clearly, if something were to happen, like, whatever, Syria downs a US aircraft or whatever, that would have gold would move up, but it would probably be a short-term effect.
Commerce Bank lowered its price forecast for silver at the end of 2024 to $29 per ounce from $30. But it expects silver to noticeably outperform gold on the back of a positive outlook for industrial demand and ongoing transformation of the economy towards climate neutrality, in which silver plays an important role. Adrian Day, founder of Adrian Day Asset Management, is a renowned financial expert known for his insights into investment strategies. In this video, Adrian states about silver's outperformance over gold, especially in the early stages of a gold bull market. Gold surpassing $2,100 is predicted to trigger a sustained decline in the gold-to-silver ratio this cycle, with mainstream investors viewing silver as a more accessible alternative as gold hits new highs. As expectations build around silver's potential, this influx of investment demand from retail buyers could help drive the ratio dramatically lower. Historically, silver has tended to lag gold early in precious metals bull markets. However, once silver kicks into gear, it tends to massively outperform gold in the middle and later stages. For example, from 1970 to 1980, as precious metals boomed, gold gained over 2,500%. Meanwhile, silver absolutely skyrocketed, gaining close to 6,000% in that decade. On the other hand, Adrian also questions the lasting impact of geopolitical events on gold, citing brief effects unless gold is already rising. Gold prices have gained by more than 8%, testing a 9-week high of $1,985 an ounce since October 7th, when the decade-long clash between Israel and Palestine culminated into a war. While acknowledging that isolated events could prompt spikes, he believes these effects are generally temporary. Now, we present the clips of Adrian Day's insights from his recent interview with Liberty and Finance. Before we continue to delve into this discussion, please subscribe to our channel and activate the bell icon for timely updates.
Been a significant change in the supply structure of silver over the last quarter century, let's say. And that is, and different from gold, whereas most gold is still primary production, the vast majority of silver is byproduct. And that's very, very significant because it means that the producer of zinc or the producer of lead does not change his production because the price of silver changes. And that's one of the reasons why silver tends to move higher, tends to move faster, both on the upside and the downside, because we don't get these changes in production. Now, we all know, of course, that even with gold, the changes in output happen slowly. They don't happen instantly. But still, there is a response from producers when the price of gold changes meaningfully. But again, there's no specific change to silver production when the price of silver changes. Obviously, if we go into a recession, then we start to get a change in the production of, let's say, zinc, and that affects the supply of silver. But, typically, you can go back, 50 years, as I've done with some graphs, typical slides, typically geopolitical events have very short-term effects on the price of gold. They tend to have a longer-term impact if gold is already in an up move, and also if the market generally thinks that the geopolitical event is going to worsen and deepen. But you go back 40 years, and whether it's 9/11, or whether it's the invasion of Iraq, these things tended to have a short-term effect on the price of gold. Not only from a sort of humanitarian point of view, I don't like to profit from other people's suffering, but I think it's a mistake to think that gold will move up and sustain those moves because of geopolitical events. So clearly, I'm not a geopolitical strategist, but clearly, if something were to happen, like, you know, whatever, Syria downs a US aircraft or whatever, that would have, gold would move up. But it would probably be a short-term effect. If you're buying for insurance, for security, for safety, you want to be as close to owning physical in your own grubby hands as you possibly can be. An ETF is, to me, an investment. It's not the same as holding the physical gold. And Lobo is absolutely right. The fact that it's difficult to sell physical, when I say difficult, it's more difficult, is actually a positive.
During the interview, Adrian Day pointed out anomalies in the undervaluation of leading gold mining companies. Gold stocks kept pace with gold in the first part of the rally. However, just as gold approached $2,000, surprisingly, they lost steam and gave back half of their earlier gains. NYSE Arca Gold Miners and the MVIS Global Juniors Gold Miners Index were up 4.2% and 3.8% during the month, respectively. Gold stocks' significant underperformance further widens the valuation gap between gold stocks and gold. Furthermore, he stressed prioritizing senior miners and royalty companies, citing their prompt and reliable response to rising gold prices. Valued at $23.5 billion by market cap, Agnico Eagle is a senior gold mining company that produces precious metals. In the third quarter of 2023, Agnico produced 850,000 ounces of gold, generating $1.64 billion in sales, an increase of 13% year over year. Its net income more than doubled to $179 million in Q3, enabling further dividend hikes. Let's get back to the interview.
If you look at Agnico Eagle, third largest gold mining company in the world, it is selling in the lowest 10 percentile of its price to cash flow for the last 30 years, which is basically most of a company's history. But just think about that for a second. The lowest 10 percentile of its price to cash flow, when gold is at 1950 or 1960, as we talk, gold is not at 250 anymore. You know, multiples normally expand when the price goes up. Not only is gold at 1950, but I would argue that the profit margin, or the cash margins, let's say, reasonably robust right now. I mean, if the average gold mining cash cost is $950 and all-in sustaining costs $1,250 to $1,300, gold is at $1,960, you've got a fairly good margin there. Now, there's other things that go into that. We can talk about it later if you want. But that's just one example. Another example would be Barrick. Barrick is the second largest gold mining in the world. It is selling today at its lowest ever price to book value. I would argue that simply doesn't make sense. You can talk about Barrick and everything that's wrong with Barrick all you like, and the arguments about what's wrong with Barrick don't necessarily apply to Agnico Eagle, but you can talk about everything that's wrong. But then I ask you, should it be trading at its lowest ever price to book value? And I would argue no. I think that the senior miners and the senior royalty companies as well are where you should be emphasizing right now, because they are not only the first to move when gold takes off, but they're also the more certain to move. You know, I could name five stocks, you know, Kinross, Agnico, Barrick, Franco, whatever. And I can almost guarantee you that if gold goes to 2,500, I can, again, as close as anything in investment, I can almost guarantee you that those five will all be up. I could pick five juniors, Consolidated, Ajax, and Moose Pasture Incorporated, and they may or may not be up. So the seniors are the first to move, and they're the more certain to move. So at this point in the cycle, I think you want to be emphasizing that. Having said that, some of the juniors, and I always look for juniors, I'm sorry to jump around a bit, I always look for juniors that either have strong balance sheets or have some sort of income. And there are some revenue. If we head into a recession, it could be difficult for some of the juniors to raise meaningful amounts of money. So I emphasize the ones that have good balance sheets. Some of these are just remarkably undervalued. And over the next 4 weeks, you're going to see some astonishing buys because of taxable selling. You can look at some of his juniors and they might do 20, 30, 50,000 shares. Well, here's Midland. It's done 15,000 shares today at 40 cents. You know, just do the math. That's not a lot of money. You need one person with $10,000 or $20,000 worth to say, I'm going to take a tax loss, and the stock goes down. It goes down. These juniors go down because one person says to his broker, sell my stock for a tax loss. And so we need to be in there with stink bids. We also need to be in there alert. When you see a stock go down 3, 4, 5 cents, you know, on a 40-cent stock, you need to be there to buy it.
The historical context of silver lagging behind gold early in bull markets, but later surging ahead, provides a compelling narrative for investors to consider. The interplay of economic transformation, industrial demand, and geopolitical factors intricately shapes the future paths of these precious metals. As we advance, what factors do you believe will significantly influence the future performance of silver and gold? Share your thoughts in the comment section below. If you find this video informative, don't forget to support our channel and turn on notifications to stay informed about our latest videos. See you in the next video.